I'd like to thank the organizing committee for and the SGA for the kind invitation. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the kind introduction. It's always a pleasure to be back in Jeddah for the SDDF. So I'm going to talk about endoscopic hemostasis. Endoscopic hemostasis is probably the most important technical aspect in endoscopy that needs to be mastered by gastroenterologists. It's not only important, it's not only essential in the management of upper GI bleed, but it's important in the prevention of bleeding during endoscopic intervention. These are my disclosure. I'm going to briefly talk about upper GI bleed, mentioning the standard endoscopic hemostasis available. And then finally, going through some of the novel evolving hemostatic technologies. It's undoubtful that upper GI bleed carries an economical and healthcare burden. It's a common disease. The incidence is approximately 100 per 100,000. In the US, there is approximately 300,000 hospital admissions per year. Majority of upper GI bleed are non-venesal. It's also important to remember that 1 in a 10 of a major warfarin bleed are actually fatal, and 1 in a 12 will re-bleed after resuming anticoagulation. Everyone probably aware about the most common etiology is peptic ulcer disease. These are other factor or etiologies. Portal hypertensive constitute around 20% of causes. It's mainly esophageal and gastric varices. When we have a patient with an upper GI bleed, it's part of the clinical pathway to us to risk stratify the disease. The most widely acceptable and validated score is the Glasgow Platform score. A score of less than 1 probably indicate no need for endoscopic management. A patient can be safely managed as an outpatient. And a score of more than 6 will likely need an endoscopic intervention. Another ROCO score, which has been replaced mainly with Glasgow score, the main limitation of the score is that it includes an endoscopic criteria. It's very difficult to talk about endoscopic hemostasis and not mentioning the role of pharmacological therapy, particularly PPI. These two modalities go hand in hand. We all know that PPI increases the pH of the gastric stomach, that helps stabilize the clot. We have an accumulating strong level of evidence suggests that pre-procedure PPI is probably not necessary. Most of the society now recommend against routine use of PPI, of pre-procedure PPI, in patient with suspected upper GI bleed. However, PPI does downgrade the lesion, which can ultimately minimize the need for endoscopic intervention. There is no evidence that IV PPI infusion is better than intermittent infusion. Most importantly, post-procedure PPI have shown that it does reduce mortality, as well as re-bleeding in patients who had endoscopic management for high-risk stigmatized lesion. We always teach our fellows when they proceed with an endoscopy for a patient who suspected upper GI bleed is to describe the endoscopic appearance. It's actually a standard of care to document that in the endoscopy report, as it provides an important prognostic information as well as guide the need for endoscopic intervention. So if we used Forest classification, we classify a patient based on the appearance into a low risk or a high risk based on the recent stigmata of hemorrhage. The first two is probably a low risk, being a clean base ulcer or a pigmented spot. These patients probably doesn't need endoscopic hemostasis. When we go to the higher risk population, where you see a visible clot, or you see a visible vessels, or you see a spurting arterial bleed, these probably will definitely need an endoscopic hemostasis. The higher the risk, the higher the re-bleeding. Without endoscopic treatment, the risk of further bleeding, need for surgery and mortality is high. So what hemostatic devices are available? We have three types of endoscopic hemostasis that has been shown in randomized control trial to be effective. We have the injection therapy, the mechanical therapy, including is CLIPS and ligation. And we have the thermal therapy, which we can divide it into a contact and a non-contact modality. So most injection solution that we use is epinephrine. We rarely use ethanol, we know ethanol nowadays. The usual concentration is 1 in a 10,000 or 1 in a 10,000. These cause hemostasis by causing local vasoconstriction and local temperature, as well as activation of the platelets. The main advantage of epinephrine injection is that it does work nicely and smoothly in a difficult lesion, in difficult tangential lesions, particularly on the retroflexion position or in the posterior duodenal bulb. However, accumulating evidence suggests that epinephrine monotherapy is not recommended alone. These are based on several meta-analyses that showed that monotherapy with epinephrine is less effective than other monotherapy modality. There are a few case series indicate that the more of epinephrine volume you give, the probably less likely of rebleeding. I.e., if you, the most of these case series describe giving up to 45 ml of epinephrine to minimize the risk of rebleeding. However, currently there is no standard rule for how much epinephrine we should give. Moving on into thermal therapy, these are usually involved in bipolar probe. We have two sizes, 7 French and 10 French. Again, the advantage is that it's easily applied in a difficult tangential lesions. The most important thing of using this modality is that when you apply the thermal probe, whether it's a heat probe or a bipolar probe, you need to firmly apply pressure on the base of the ulcers. Putting a superficial pressure will probably cause more resistant oozing and bleeding. You need to have a cavitation or a footprint. That's the end result that you need to have, which is a whitish. Recommended to use combination of epinephrine with either thermal or mechanical. based on the location of the lesion, and based on the assistant and nursing experience, as well as the available tool. There are several independent risk factors for knee bleeding. These are the most important risk factor. If you have a large ulcer, more than 2 centimeters, if you have an active knee bleeding with the hypovolemic shock, if the ulcers in the distal curve or in the duodenal posterior wall, these are independent risk factors for knee bleeding. Briefly about band ligation, it's the standard of care in managing varicose bleed. Band ligation has been shown to be superior on in comparison to sclerosing agent with regard to knee bleeding, complication, and mortality. In cases of refractory varicose bleed, there is a growing small evidence supporting the use of dedicated expandable stent, fully covered stent, as a rescue therapy or as a bridge. There is a meta-analysis that included 13 studies. The quality is really low, as all these studies are case series. They included a total of 134 patients with refractory bleed. The success rate was around 95%, and around 96% achieved hemostasis. However, there is a drawback for that. It carries a high risk of complication. Risk of migration is approximately 30%. Risk of pre-bleeding is approximately 15%. And also there is a risk of ulceration. So it's always recommended to remove the stent within a week of deployment. I don't think it should replace TIPS as a standard of care for refractory bleed, but it can be used as a bridge. Moving on to the final part of my talk, talking about the relatively new evolving hemostatic technology. We're going to talk about hemostatic forceps, hemostatic powders, over the scope clips, and then finally briefly on the role of Doppler endoscopic probe. So I'm sure Dr. Afeta will talk about this in his next lecture. Hemostatic forceps are mainly have been used as a prophylactic or a curative hemostasis during high-risk interventional procedures such as large AMR or an EST. There's a small non-prospective randomized trial included around 50 patients compared to hemostatic forceps with the standard clip. The actually hemostatic forceps was more superior. The success rate was 100%. Rebleeding rate was less in comparison to the standard clipping. We have three available hemostatic powders. Hemospray, Indoclot, and the ABS. Hemospray is an inorganic powder that was first utilized to manage external bleed in the military personnel in the US Army. Although there is no randomized controlled trial, it has been approved for non-varicose upper GI bleed. Most of the case series and literature showed that it carry a high risk, immediate success rate of more than 90% with relatively lower rebleeding rate. It's important to know that hemostasis should not be applied to a patient with a low risk stigmata lesion. It's only applied when you have an active bleeding or an oozing lesions. The main advantage of hemostasis is act as an extinguisher. It really doesn't need skills. It's a simple way of, a simple modality of endoscopy hemostasis. The main disadvantage is that once you apply it, you probably cannot apply any other modalities, because the field has already been observed. What is the role of hemostasis in esophageal bleeding? There are some few studies. There is a recent study, a randomized controlled trial, looked at the role of hemostasis in comparison to the standard pharmacological plus endoscopic management. They showed that any application of hemostatic powder in patients with refractory upper GI bleed resulted in a reduced clinical bleeding within one day, in addition to some impact on the 30 days survival. The result is promising. It does maybe give us a hope that hemostasis can be used as a bridge therapy to TIPS if you are working in a center where you don't have TIPS capability. However, it's important to know that it's not approved for varicose bleed. It's an off-label. It shouldn't be used unless it's within a research. So this is a video showing how he was made, and sometimes be used as a first modality of choice. As you will see here, it's an arterial spurting. The area around it is friable. There's deep, large ulcers. Probably applying a clip will not hold. Probably injecting epinephrine might cause things worse. So giving hemostasis resulted in excellent hemostasis with patient in 21. So the other hemostasis available, hemostatic powder, is the endoclot. It's only available in Europe and Australia. There is no strong evidence to support it. ABS is a Turkish herbal mixture. There are more than 35 papers, all in Turkish literature, have shown that it's effective. This product is only available in Turkey. I personally have no experience. Moving on to the over the scope clip, these are new endoscopic modality that has been primarily developed to close perforation or fistula. It works like a recent band. It has a cap, goes on the top of the tip of the scope. You can also pass an anchor catheter through the working channel to grab the tissue and maximize or facilitate the accumulation of tissue within the cap to close the lesions or to close the bleeding lesions. More than 140 patients have been reported in the literature with a clinical success rate of around 90%. Recurrent bleeding rate from 5 to 33%. Main lesions were treated with the ovascular includes peptic ulcer disease, malady-wise, and anastomotic bleeding. Its main advantage over the standard clip, it works easily on tangential lesions and difficult lesions, as in the posterior bump. This is one of the only randomized control trial looking at the role of ovisco or over the scope clips in patients with upper GI bleed, published in Gastroenterology. It's a multi center international study, the STIM study. It's looked at the role of over the scope versus standard therapy in patients with recurrent peptic ulcer bleed. They included 66 patients randomized 1-to-1 to the standard therapy. Which in the standard therapy they didn't allow more than two modalities, as well as the other arm includes over the scope. It's a crossover design. So patients who fail standard therapy will move to the over the scope arm. As you can see here, the primary endpoint, which was defined by persistent bleeding or after achieving hemostasis, sorry, persistent bleeding despite hemostasis, or pre-bleeding after achieving initial hemostasis within 7 days. As you can see here, the rate of free bleeding or further bleeding is higher in the standard therapy group. Not surprisingly, more harder outcome were not significant, probably because of the small sample size and the crossover design. It does have significant limitation. There is a significant heterogeneity in the PPI treatment. This is an unblinded study, so more studies are needed. Although the Asia Pacific recent updated guidelines actually recommending over the scope in, as a salvage therapy in refractory upper GI bleed, and they see a role for it as a first line modality. So it will be added, or it has already been added to the armamentarium of the endoscopic hemostasis. Finally, I'm going to talk about Doppler endoscopic probe. Can we raise the sound, please? We need the sound. So the role of ultrasound in detecting arterial blood flow is not new. It was first described in 1982. It's a small catheter that can be passed through a working channel of a diagnostic or a therapeutic gastroscope or a colonoscope. Yeah, go back to the video, please. Sorry. now, please. Anyhow, so you apply it firmly. You should hear an arterial waveform. This is a tool that can risk stratify a lesion. It helps you decide which lesion needs to be treated, and it also helps the endoscopist to know when to stop endoscopic therapy. Unfortunately, you can't hear it, but when you apply the probe firmly, you will see a wish sound, which is an indication of an arterial waveform. As long as you see this positive Doppler sound, you continue your hemostasis until no waveform are audible, indicating an excellent and defined hemostasis. Fortunately, there is no sound. So this is the only randomized control trial recently published in Gastroenterology in late 2018. Looked at the role of Doppler endoscopic probe in comparison to the standard visual assessment endoscopic hemostasis. It's a long recruitment. It took 9 years to screen 900 patients, and they included only 148. This is one of the limitations. They divided patients into a Doppler-assisted or Doppler-guided endoscopic management versus standard visual-guided endoscopic management. They found that the rebleeding rate is significantly less in a Doppler-guided management. So this study was published from two larger referral centers, the VA centers and the Cure Center in LA. These are experienced endoscopists. So probably the result is probably more pronounced if it's applied in clinical practice, because you suspect these experienced gastroenterologists to have achieved a good endoscopic hemostasis with the standard mortality. In the study, most of the patients that included were a severe upper GI bleed defined by need for cut transfusion or hemodynamic instabilities. They included patients with peptic ulcer disease, dual form, and Mallory Weiss. There's a significant decrease in the primary outcome, which is 30 days of bleeding. There is also an insignificant improvement in the secondary outcome in the form of surgery, death, and need for blood transfusion. The author concluded that we need 7 patients to prevent 1 episode of bleeding if we apply this tool. Finally, in the last decades, endoscopic hemostasis technique has grown parallel to the number of devices available, hemostatic powders, over-the-scope, hemostatic forceps, and other emerging technology has changed the daily practice of our patient management of GI bleed. Supportive and pharmacological management goes hand in hand. The most important thing is overcoming endoscopic hemostasis, which constitute the first steps before proceeding with intervention and procedure. The best combination of endoscopic hemostasis should give us the highest rate of hemostasis, should minimize rate of bleeding and adverse event, it should be easily applicable to all lesions, and finally, and most importantly, it should be less expensive. Thank you.